Welcome to this QServe podcast on the MDR Deadline Countdown. My name is Gert Bos, I'm CSO at QServe, and I will be your host today. The podcast series is a series where we talk about the implementation of the MDR in the IVDR. And if you want to follow us on the podcast channel called QServe Talk, that would be great and get ready to get the insights from all of our experts over time. In our last episode, together with Sue Spencer, we discussed some of the issues about the IVDR implementation. And today we will address the topic of artificial intelligence. And joining me for that is Koenraad Davidsdochter, QServe software expert. With over 20 years of experience in software development, over which 10 years in setting up and maintaining an improving quality management system, we'd be happy to welcome Koenraad to this podcast.
Well, thank you very much.
A pleasure to work with you. Every episode, I'd like to kick off with one general question, and this time I'd like to ask you what your favorite medical device is and why.
Basically, it's going back to my roots in the medical device world a bit, because it's basically the monitoring systems in all shapes and sizes that I'm still very interested in. But I have to admit that lately I've been involved in quite a number of IVD projects, and I find it quite intriguing as well.
Excellent. Intriguing. That is a nice bridge to the AI, basically. And I guess more and more companies find this as a useful marketing tool to use the word AI and make their product more fancy, basically. So we see and we hear a lot about artificial intelligence, and it's been talked about for a long time. Is that still the case? Is it woolly and fluffy as in sci-fi movies, or do we actually see AI-based products in the medical device market?
Well, actually, quite different than a couple of years ago. Hey, you no longer need a telescope to find AI in healthcare. It's all over the place, and you can find it everywhere. In a lot of areas, it's still starting, but in some areas, it's already quite mature. Like, for instance, in radiology, where AI is being used already for quite some years. And I've been involved lately even in some projects within pathology, and where you also there now see that artificial intelligence is coming. That is in an area where even the digitalization of the workflow is still not common. And actually, a lot of these IVDs also use AI algorithms. So when I look forward, then in this current development, if this will continue, it will not be long before AI will be lighting the healthcare sky.
And so as we are now live after the date of application of the European MDR, and the IVDR is getting very close, with the deadline being next year, what are the key requirements these legislative frameworks provide for manufacturers of AI-based medical devices? And what are the aspects manufacturers and notified bodies seem to be most struggling with?
Well, maybe not surprisingly, but it basically starts with using the GDPR, so the General Safety Performance Requirements, and the standards that are identified that you use to prove compliance. And if I look for software requirements, then it's specific, the standard IEC 60304 comes in mind in combination with risk management ISO 14971. So these are still the basics also with your AI device. And every AI device will need a proper risk assessment. And for the risk associated with these devices are a little bit different than with common medical of IVD devices. And you must make sure and that your documentation is set up according to IEC 60304. What is important, though, with AI systems is that the validation data set is kept apart from the learning data set, so that these two never can meet. But there are no specific requirements for AI medical IVD devices taken into account the learning of the AI-based device, post-market modifications for systems that will continue learning, the use of data sets. So no specific requirements in the MDR or IVDR. And also, the current requirements, they do not take into account the specific nature of AI-based devices. What you see is that both manufacturers and notified bodies struggle because of this lack of clarity.
And so in this case, you talk about learning data sets, and you also mention the systems that continue to learn. And I guess that's a topic that I hear more and more about, how we could move from what most current products have, a frozen stepwise approach to use the AI basically as a research element in the device, and once in a while take the lessons learned and adjust the product and move it into more state-of-the-art use for artificial intelligence, where the AI actually is learning it live and is integrated completely into the product approval.
Yes, indeed. So more and more AI-based devices continue to learn after being put on the market. So it's not only this frozen system that you learn and train, and then you freeze them and then you put it on the market. So these frozen systems are relatively easy to contain because after you put them on the market, they're really constant. And for these AI-based systems, the devices that keep learning, there is a challenge. Well, how do you convince your notified body that the model will be kept between certain boundaries that you'll have set for your device, and that you can make sure that that your device will be safe also in the long run? You have to make sure that your device will be safe during the lifetime of the device, so this will need to have some consideration. And the current regulation offers little guidance on how this should be done. And it is of no use to deny that these learning AI-based devices will be out there. And regulators better come up with some mechanism to provide guidance to both manufacturers and notified bodies on how to handle this.
So if I hear you correctly, it's all about finding a way to validate this, basically, the thinking, the essence of the AI system rather than the output. So that would be challenging to start validating something which keeps on changing. And I guess, indeed, as you say, guidance would be more than welcome. Now let's move to this latest debate we see in Europe, where the European Commission has started to draft horizontal legislation on artificial intelligence. So that kind of is supporting, but perhaps also contradicting the product-specific legislation like we have, for instance, for our MDR and IVDR. So this draft legal framework is now up for consultation. And if one were to compare this framework to the existing requirements spelled out in our well-known MDR and IVDR, do you think there's enough overlap, or are there discrepancies? And what elements do these cover? Where would we find solutions to merge and match these requirements?
Well, that's quite a big question that you ask, but I am familiar with this AI regulation proposal. And what you see in this proposal that a lot of things overlap, especially in the conformity assessment, government structure, QMS requirements. So that is basically very familiar for if you are used to MDR, IVDR. Basically, all medical devices that require notified body involvement are considered to be high-risk AI devices, according to this new proposal, and those will need to comply with the requirements set out in this proposal. And there are a lot of new requirements. It's like keeping of specific logs. Those are intended to keep track of the behaving of the system. Is it still behaving as intended? There are transparency requirements and requirements for human oversight. So it must enable, users or other persons to have an oversight over the correct functioning of this AI system. So there will need to be some translations done for the manufacturers on how to enable users to monitor such systems. And these obligations for the user, those are quite clearly defined. And this is quite new, and this will need also exposure of information to enable the users to comply with these requirements. Another thing is a new concept of AI sandboxes and codes of conduct. And the AI sandboxes basically intend to help manufacturers to innovate. This is some sort of a learning environment. That is controlled, being set up by member states of the data protection agency. And there you can develop your system before placing on the market in a controlled way. And the codes of conduct are voluntary, but basically that can be on any area. But one of the things that you could think of, that's for manufacturers of not high-risk AI systems, to voluntary say follow the requirements of this proposed regulation. There are no real discrepancies, but there are some remarkable differences in definitions. This is quite quite a shock for me that there, in these definitions there are differences, and those can make it really difficult to compare what is really meant in one regulation or in the other. The notified bodies need to be designated. That is also important to know. And it's not to say for sure that your MDR, IVDR notified body will also be designated for this AI regulation. And if I have to think of a couple of solutions, I would say that the requirements for products need incorporation in product documentation. Like we have now guidance to apply the IEC 60304 for AI medical devices. But how would this work for AI systems? And the risk management should be extended. For how would you evaluate risk for learning AI systems? So there needs to be some additional work for this, and it would be good if there can be some additional guidance for this. But although the EU AI proposal poses big challenges for manufacturers, in my view, everyone will benefit in the end for the clarity on how to comply. But it's to prove of the pudding is in the eating. Then we will see the real burden this poses on all parties involved. But resources in the QA and RA, that will be continued to be a challenge.
So quite a lot of challenges I see ahead of us then. If you talk about not matching definitions, maybe some additional or different requirements, maybe another notified body that's going to look at this. So manufacturers will need to start communicating well ahead of time with the various notified bodies, I'm sure, to make sure there's a plan that's going to be accepted by all their notified bodies moving forward. I have a little question about these sandboxes. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit more on that. So these seem to be done playgrounds. Is that in any way related to this stepwise approach used currently, or is it only for innovative devices where you can use the sandboxes, or is it also for continuous improvement stepwise for existing AI systems?
It's really meant for innovative AI devices. Basically, it will support the training of these systems and the learning of these systems. There are also quite a lot of guidance on how to comply with GDPR requirements for the data that's being used. And basically, if your system is then ready for a market, this period in the sandbox, this will end, and the data that has been used will need to be removed either directly after using the sandbox or after the retention time. It is usually set at 1 year after you have completed your period in the sandbox.
Right, and as such, we can see it a little bit then as an easier way to collect data instead of having formalized clinical trials and so on. And I guess that might be, well, not trying to see how everyone's going to use it, but it might be helpful in that sense. On the other hand, I would be, I'm not sure you didn't mention, but is there any protection of the knowledge that is being generated for a particular manufacturer, or is this the fact that you use the sandbox that gives everyone access to the data being generated?
No, the data itself is protected, so that is be made secure. And basically, I didn't mention yet, but they're specifically aimed also at the smaller manufacturers for who it's difficult to do such research themselves. So this will enable them to have easier access to those kinds of development platforms for developing their device.
So that's excellent. So specifically for the smaller development companies and so on and so on. And I guess there will be some challenges in integrating basically the requirements from this legislation with our existing medical device legislation. On the other hand, there might also be some best practices later on then that also for different non-AI based medical devices, we could start to explore using more of these sandboxes. And I guess getting your clinical data, PMCF data, and so on in a shared community way might actually be something fun that could come out of this AI legislation in the long run. I guess it will take some time for us all to learn from that. And so, unfortunately, Konrad, we have come to an end of our episode. I hope you you liked this.
Yes, thank you very much for letting me attend.
And I guess there will be some follow-up once this legislation is a little bit closer to life. I guess we should promise the listeners that we come back and provide them with an update on this moving target. And thank you so far for providing us with your great insights. For now, I'd like to wish you all a lovely week, and I hope to talk to you soon in our next episodes. So keep an eye on our website and on the social media, and see you soon in our next podcast. Thank you.